episode of U Video Spotlight, we have very special guests. He's been referred to as the Mad Scientist, Baby Belichick, and even Pete Carroll of the YFL. He is the architect of a budding dynasty for the Redstone Ravens, and he is fresh off a championship in the YFF JV level. He won in postseason play at the Catch Cover Elite Championship and the R&R Winter Bowl in Pearland. Today, our guest is Coach Mark Gibson. How you doing today, Coach?
Doing fine. Thank you for having me.
We sure appreciate you coming out today. This season, you'll be entering your sixth season. You're fresh off the championship. Y'all still feeling, you still riding the high, or how you come down back to business?
I'm hitting the ground about every third step right now. But, no, we're getting to it because with it being May, we're already, you know, full on into the spring season. In fact, we've got our last camp coming up this weekend, and so we're turning our attention to 2016, that's for sure.
Yeah, I always feel the very, very good team, more times than not the favorite. And y'all finally got over the hump this year. A couple games should have won, maybe didn't go your way. I mean, how did it feel to finally get that accomplishment?
Yeah, that was a great accomplishment. This past year's team was really a special bunch. I mean, and you can see that from all the hardware here, that not only were we able to compete in our league, but we were able to go out and take on teams that were all-star teams a lot of times and still beat them. So in a lot of ways, we had our own all-star team playing throughout the season. And so, you know, for me last year, the big challenge was trying to keep everybody together, because it's like coaching a dream team out there. I don't know that we'll ever have another group that's like that. And so what was special about last year's squad is nobody had won it all yet, so everybody was very hungry.
27-game regular season winning streak, that's very impressive. Speak on the consistency and success game after game.
Well, like I said, I think a lot of that consistency starts with the coaching staff and you know, being able to, we put our vision together, and you know, we get a lot of talk about our offense, but our defense is consistently one of the top, if not the top. I mean, we had a year where we weren't scored on for 9 straight games, and you know, I think this year defense was slacking a little bit. We actually average giving up 2.5 points a game, right? You know? So, I mean,
it's kind of a consensus across the league that the Ravens are well coached. Speaking to the job that you guys do over there, the numbers back that up. When you're always in the top of the division, offense and defense. Multiple seasons where you go throughout the season not giving up any points for, you know, long periods of time, and the offense is very hard to contain. Speak about your regimen is in practice to execute like that when it's game time.
When we started this, way back when, a lot of people didn't really think, well, a lot of the stuff that we were doing offensively and defensively, kids could learn. They were like, oh, you're doing too much, it's too complicated for them. And I'm like, no, kids are sponges, and if you teach them, and don't just teach them the what, but teach them the why, you know, because you can tell a kid, hey, take 2 steps and hit this hole or whatever. Why am I doing that, Coach?
Man, I look out there at your team, and sometimes it's, you know, look like you're looking at a college team operate out there as far as the, you know, how complicated it is, and people moving all over the place, and I mean, it's a lot going on out there.
A couple of us did play college ball. We were fortunate to do that, and we've had coaches on our staff in the past that have been in college, and so we do kind of run it like a college practice out there. That's what we know. Charlie Strong, Kevin Sumlin, they're not coming down and offering me the offensive coordinator job because I get 6 of these or whatever. And they're also not coming down and offering some kid based off of what they do at 9 and 10 years old. But if I can lay the foundation for them, I'd trade all this hardware up here for more of my kids ultimately ending up getting scholarships.
Curiosity of mine, I've never had a chance to ask you this, but the signs with the grapefruits and the rocking chairs, and the, I mean, it, does that really give those kids a cue, or is it just a distraction? I mean, or is it really a play?
Well, if I told you, I'd have to kill you, Kale. But no, we utilize them on different things. Sometimes it's formation, sometimes it's play call, sometimes it's snap count, sometimes it's hole. You know, so there's different things within that. We've done everything. Signals, we've done wristbands, we've done, you know, the quarterback to the sideline, all that kind of stuff. So, you know, and we kind of tweak it every year. It's a work in progress, and it was a combination of, you know, lots of things I had seen and been exposed to throughout my time in the game.
It seems to has trickled through your organization as well. You see some similarities. I've seen them holding up the grapefruits on other levels, you know.
Coach Reggie was with the sophomores last year, and he took a version of my offense and utilized it and all. But, I mean, he's been with us so many years, and we all knew that sophomore group was going to be very special, and they proved it. You know, they had a great season as well, you know, undefeated and Super Bowl championship, and they won, you know, postseason tournament as well.
Well, if you knew the sophomore level was going to be good, then maybe the freshman level snuck up on you, and, I mean, they turned out to be solid as well. I mean,
Coach Corey did a great job down there. They were a couple of horses short of what they needed. But, you know, in Little League, freshman and varsity is always a crapshoot every year.
One level away from four teams in the championship. What do you have in store to show up that varsity level?
You know, the varsity will be fine. And freshmen, we've got a good nucleus returning and some new guys coming over that'll be fine. Sophomore will get a lot of those freshmen that made the Super Bowl moving up, as well as they've got a fair amount of their boys staying down. And then with JV, while we lose a lot, you know, we don't really rebuild. We just try to reload, you know, so to speak.
Ending champs. I mean, you go in there holding the belt, protecting your title. Do you think y'all can get it done back to back? I mean,
too early to tell on that for a number of reasons. Like, until I see people out on the practice field, I don't know exactly what we have yet. And then you don't know what the other teams have had. I can usually tell you by about week three, just between how we've played and what we've seen score-wise from other games and that kind of stuff. Of, are we looking at, you know, championship? Are we looking at playoffs? Are we looking at a bad season? You know, that kind of thing.
Anybody that's on your radar now that you know that it's going to be a good one when y'all hook up?
No, not anybody in particular. I mean, I guess you got to say, you know, the Bulldogs made the Super Bowl last year, and so I suspect as a first-year squad making the Super Bowl that if they've got that kind of talent to load up for 1 year, that they'll probably have it again. And, you know, I told you this, but I told their coaches after the game that, you know, they've got nothing to be ashamed of for them, because I was there a couple of years before, right? And I know that sick feeling that they have, but, I mean, they accounted for themselves very well.
Those guys came out focused. I've never seen a team on the JV level complete passes at a rate that they did. So, you know, I stand here and hold myself accountable, and it wasn't as close as I thought it'd be. Were you surprised with the outcome? Did it turn out about like you thought it would?
Swinging like a swing set, brandy wine paint with coming down, that's a bit. I'm in